Praise the Lord.
So glad that Jesus loves me.
Yes.
Jesus loves even.
Indeed.
Even me. Filthy and unfit for service. But the Lord still loves me. Not able to always do everything that he has asked us to do. By his grace and mercy, he loves each one of us. We know he loves us because he woke us up early this morning.
Hallelujah.
He gave us a chance to see a day we never seen before. We are grateful to the God of our salvation who would give us another chance. Come to the house of worship one more time. God bless you. God bless you and keep you. God sustain you. May the power of God be upon you. So you continue. Stay strong. To not give up. Seems like everybody is giving up these days. People are quitting. So they had enough. Going back. Repeatedly going fishing, going back to my ways. But this is not the time to quit. This is not the time to give up. This is the time to hold on. See what the end's going to be. For God before us is more than the world has ever been against us. He told us in the text that greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world. Because we have a greater one in us, we are more than conquerors through Christ, who loved us, gave his life for each one of us. And so with that, we say, we thank God. Just another chance. I don't count it anything that should have happened that we're here today. But I thank God because he allowed us to come one more time. He didn't have to do it, but he did. I'm grateful to the Lord that he keeps on waking me up every day, giving me another chance to work on my own soul salvation and be able to just try and please him in whatever way we can do. Amen.
Amen.
Revelation chapter 15, as we said earlier, we're coming on around the bend now. We're going to conclude this series of messages and teachings. We're going to move on in the Lord and ask God to bless us to see what he has to say to us. We want to do what God says to do. We want to hear what God has to say to the church. It's not about me, but it's all about God.
Amen.
It's all about the Lord. And so we want to just bless the name of Jesus every time we get a chance. Revelation chapter 15 is the text today. It's only 8 verses. Didn't take long, right? We hope so. Let's see what how the Lord leads us into doing this today. Then God, we ask you to bless us since we made this attempt to study your word, to teach and to preach under the power and the unction of the Holy Spirit. Now, God, we ask you to lead this, your servant, to lead your people into the light and the truth and the glorious truth of your gospel. Lord God, let your word feed us. You said, faith come by hearing, hearing by the word of God. Mm-hmm. And so that God, we ask you to strengthen our faith as we look into the book that has been written for our consideration. Lord, we thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right. We're going to just dive right in and see what happens. Revelation chapter 15, verse 1. John is the writer, and John is continuing with the apocalyptic message to the church, originally to the seven churches of Asia, but to the churches of us also. And so we want to look and see what is being said by this great apostle. He was talking about in Sunday school this morning, and it was so excellently looked upon. Peter, talked about them being discipled, about their deaths and their lives. And so John, as we said earlier this morning, was on the Isle of Patmos. He's still in exile as he delivers his message. He's still in exile for the testimony of Christ, for being a preacher of the gospel, for being one who would stand up and say what it is that thus saith the Lord. He went into exile for that. And so John said, and I saw another sign in heaven. He saw another sign in heaven. John is on earth and he's looking into heaven. He's looking and God reveals to him some things that only he could see. Some things that deal with our future on this earth. And so these are things that we need to give credence to and to give understanding to, because these are things that will affect our future. John saw another sign in heaven, and the sign was great and marvelous. The sign was great, it was marvelous, and it astonished John to see what he saw in this sign. He saw seven angels, that were the seven last plagues. For in them is filled up the wrath of God. Know that seven in the Bible is the number of completion. That when seven is issued or seven is given, is the number of completion. Now you remember the number of the beast of the Antichrist was 666, which showed he couldn't reach seven. He was incomplete. He wanted to be God, but he was not able to be perfected to be God. And so here we see seven angels having the seven last plagues. Herein is the message revealed that God is done dealing with mankind with grace and mercy, and now it's time for judgment to be met out. It's time for the wrath of God to be poured out upon those who will not hear what God has said, upon those who will not accept the truth of God's gospel, upon those who have accepted at this point in time the mark of the beast and have made a decision that their God will be Satan and the Antichrist and the false prophet. And so this wrath of God has worked up its way to now. It's being filled, and it's time for payday to come. God has said it's been thousands and thousands of years now. You've had opportunities. And now I've got to pour out my wrath. But before he pours out his wrath, John sees some other things that took place. Some things that were significant, and it deals with those who had been through the tribulation, had not taken the mark of the beast, had not worshiped the image of the beast, and thus, as was said earlier, were beheaded for the testimony of Christ. And so we go to verse 2 and says, and I saw, as it were, a sea of glass. But it wasn't just a sea of glass, it was mingled with what? Fire. With fire. Mingled with fire or mixed with fire. So in other words, it was a sea that was clear, but a part of it was red as fire. And them, look at the part of the next part, and them that had gotten the victory over the beast and over his image and over his mark and over the number of his name, stand on the sea of glass, having the hearts of who? Of God. They had the hearts of God. What would they do with a harp? Play the harp. Yeah, why would they play it? Would they sad when they play it? They were joyous. Then why would they do joyous? Look at the text. They had what? Say again? They had the victory over the beast, not only over the beast, but what else? Over his image. What else? His mark. And the number of his name. What was the number of his name? 666. That was the number of his name. And so these persons were ones who had been through the great tribulation. But yet they had made a decision that they were not going to bow down to the beast, that they were not going to worship his image, that they were not going to take the mark that they needed to buy and sell with, and that they were not going to have the 666 put on their forehead or on their hand. And remember back in the Texas earlier where it said that those that didn't take the mark would be killed. And so that's when these persons had been beheaded for the cause of Christ, because they were determined they were not going to suffer the consequences of those who took the mark of the beast. Because remember earlier, in our earlier text, it was told us that those that take the mark of the beast would suffer, would die, would be tormented by God. Because they had basically said, we will worship God, we'll worship the devil, instead of worshiping God the Creator. They had made Satan their God. And so these persons now are ones who are standing in victory. And they're standing because they know that they had not taken the mark. They know that they had not taken the number. They had not let the image, they had not fell down to the image that was given to the beast. But these persons have been beheaded. These persons are now victorious. Look at what they do, verse number 3. And they sang the song of Moses, the servant of God. Now, what was the song of Moses? I know the song of Moses was. Sing it. All right. Great and marvelous are thy words. All right. Let's look at Exodus chapter 15 real quick. Exodus chapter 15. All right, Exodus chapter 15. And this is going to give a little more clarity as to what was told John concerning Moses and the law. All right, everybody got chapter 15, Exodus. All right, I'm going to read since I got the microphone. Then sang Moses and the children of Israel this song unto the Lord, and spake singing, saying, I will sing unto the Lord, for he hath triumphed gloriously. The horse of his rider hath he thrown into the sea. The Lord is my strength and song, and he has become my salvation. He is my God, and I prepare him an habitation. My father's God, and I will exhort him. The Lord is a man of war, the Lord is his name. Look at this. Pharaoh's chariots and his host have been cast into the sea. His chosen captain also are drowned in the Red Sea. The depths have covered them, they sink into the bottom of the stone. Thy right hand, O Lord, has become glorious in power. Thy right hand, O Lord, have dashed in pieces the enemy. And in the greatness of thine excellency, thou hast overthrown them that rose up against thee. Thou sendest forth thy wrath, which consumed them as stubble. And with the blast of thy nostrils, the waters were gathered together. The flood stood upright as a heap, and the depth were congealed in the heart of the sea. Look at what they were saying. The enemy said, I will pursue, I will overtake, I will divide the spoil. My lust shall be satisfied to fight them. I will draw my sword, my hand shall destroy them. Thou didst blow with thy wind. The sea covered them. They sank as lead in the mighty waters. Listen to the question that's asked. Who is like unto thee, O Lord, among the gods? Who is like thee, glorious in holiness, fearful in praises, doing wonders? Thou stretched out thy right hand, the earth swallowed them. Thou with thy mercy hast led them forth, the people which thou hast redeemed. Thou hast guided them in thy strength unto thy holy habitation. Can I read some more? Mm-hmm. The people shall hear and be afraid. Sorrow shall take hold of the inhabitants of Palestine. Then the dukes of Edom shall be amazed. The mighty men of Moab, trembling shall take hold upon them. All the inhabitants of Canaan shall melt away. Fear and dread shall fall upon them by the greatness of thine arm. Thou shalt be as thee still as a stone till thy people pass over, O Lord, till the people pass over which thou hast purchased. I want to go to 18. Thou shalt bring them in and plant them in the mountain, thine inheritance, in the place, O Lord, which thou hast made for thee to dwell in the sanctuary, O Lord, with thy hands have established. The Lord shall reign forever. How long? And forever. For the horse of Pharaoh went in with his chariots and with his horsemen to the sea, and the Lord brought again the waters of the sea upon them, but the children of Israel went on dry land in the midst of the sea. Now go back to Revelation 15:3. And they sang the song of Moses, the servant of God. They sung the song that Moses sung when Moses had been delivered from Pharaoh's chariots. When Moses and the Israelites had been delivered as they were being chased out of Egypt. And Pharaoh and his chariots thought they had. But God, what did God do for them?
Parted the Red
Sea. The Israelite children, they walked through on what? Dry land. But when Pharaoh and his chariots came, what happened? Waters came back and swallowed them up. So he's saying here, the same way that God saved Moses and the children of Israel from being destroyed by Pharaoh and his chariot, the same way he saved these people who would not worship the beast, who would not fall down to his image, who would not take on his mark, who would not take 666. The same way they can sing the same song that Moses sung. Huh? And the song of the Lamb. Look at what the song of the Lamb said. Great and marvelous are thy works. Who? Lord God, where? Almighty. Just and true are thy ways. Thou King of who?
Saints.
King of saints. Then the question is asked, who shall not fear thee, O Lord, and glorify thy name? In other words, we don't have enough sense to fear our God. And out of that, to glorify the name of the Lord. Huh? Why? For thou only art what? Holy. Our God is a holy God. Huh? We serve a God who's holy, who's righteous, who's just, who's merciful, and a God who does all things well.
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
Our God never makes a mistake. Huh?
Right.
You think God didn't know y'all be sitting here today? Huh? You think God didn't know that you'll come through just like the children of Israel went to the Red Sea and went in the wilderness and trying to figure out where they're going, but after a while God said, come and take a seat in my house. Oh, I can't get no witness. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. Come on and take a spot and take your rest.
Okay.
And understand that I am God and I don't forget my children. He said, I'm God, I don't forget my people. I'm God, I take care of my own.
Right.
Keep on praying and see if God don't hear you pray after a while. Now, keep on believing. God will answer your prayer. You'll hear your people cry, you'll answer. By God. Somebody say, I feel. Prayer will turn.
Great
God. Just a little talk.
With Jesus. Yes, sir.
Make everything all right.
Yes, sir.
Somebody ought to talk to him this morning. Yeah, I think you don't even know where yet. But I talked to the Lord this morning. Say, Lord, bless us.
Yes.
Great God Almighty. Dear God, I want to bless him. I want a blessing I can only get when I step into God's house and feel his presence and know that I'm with the saints and I can raise my hands and say, thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Don't you want us?
I know.
Great God Almighty, from a mighty long way.
Thank you, Lord.
Can't nobody do you like the Lord.
Nobody.
Somebody say, can't nobody.
Can't nobody.
Do me like Jesus.
Do me like Jesus.
Can't nobody.
Can't nobody.
Do God Almighty. Sometimes my earthly friends turn their back on me. Forget I even exist. Forget I'm even still laboring. But I know a man named Jesus who never turns his back on me. Physics! Who holds me up! Keeps me, make me want to keep on running on. See what the end gonna be. I won't turn around now. We've come too far. Too much grass have grown up behind us. Praise God. I ain't got nothing in my heart. I ain't trying to turn back. But I want to stay with the Lord. See what the end's going to be. Because I know after a while, payday is coming, church. And just be faithful to the Lord. He'll be faithful unto thee. Huh? He said, for all nations shall come and worship before thee. For thy judgments are being manifest. Look at five. And after that I looked, and behold, the temple of the tabernacle of the testimony in heaven was opened. In other words, God said, I'm giving you a chance, Apostle John, to take a look and to behold the temple of the tabernacle of the testimony in heaven. In other words, I'm going to let you look into the holiest of holy. I want you to look into the holiest place, the place on earth where only the high priest could go in the temple on earth. And in the temple of God, in the temple of heaven, he says, I want you to take a look, John, and see what I got in store. He said, in this place, I've got worship going on. In this place, I've got angels ministering. In this place, I've got the elders ministering. In this place, I've got the beast ministering. Everybody got their mind on Jesus in the temple of God. Oh, I went to the house of God was like that. And we come to church and everybody had their mind fixed on Jesus. So they're worried about what somebody else got on them. Why are they looking? They just don't look like they ought to be here today. All that kind of mess. But we need to get our minds focused on who we serve, who we live for, and who woke us up and brought us all this from. Amen. Great God Almighty. Who nobody but Jesus. That's what we need to focus on. Huh? He let them look in. Look what he saw. Look at six. And the seven angels. And with that seven number again. Seven angels came out of the where?
Temple.
Huh? The angels, they weren't outside playing basketball. They were in the temple. And you better believe it, the angels in the temple, they were doing what? They were praising God. Because that's their job. They praise God, but they don't have to be redeemed. We got to be redeemed, and we don't even praise God. Huh? Jesus paid it all for us. Gave his life on Calvary. Came up out the grave. Gave us everything we needed. We still won't say thank you, Lord. We'd rather let somebody else praise God while we sit there looking sophisticated. Got on my new hat, my new shoes, my new dress, and I don't want to wrinkle up my suit. So I'll let somebody else praise God. But I have determined in my heart that if nobody else won't praise him, I'll praise him all by myself. Because God's been too good to us to not give him a praise and give him a hallelujah and a thank you, Jesus. Because God has done great things. Great God Almighty. And he's still doing great things for us. Look at the temple. Seven angels came out of the place. And they came out doing business. Because these angels didn't come out to have a pity party. They didn't come out to have a party on the side. But they came out to do the business of God because they have the last seven plagues. And so they understand the angels. They came out under instruction of God. They were told exactly what to do. They were told how to do it. And they were told when to release the plagues. And so the angels follow the instructions of the master. They're not like us. God tell us to do things. We just tend to like to do things our way under our conditions. And if we feel like it, if we don't, well, we'll do it next week. Well, I've got something to tell you, my friend. Sometimes next week doesn't come. Oh, amen, somebody. Amen. You got to do what God says when he said it, right, how he said it, right then and when he said it.
Right,
all right. Thank God Almighty. Look at these angels. They were clothed in pure and white linen. The time you see white linen, that means that's righteousness. The They were clothed in righteousness, and they had their breasts girdled with golden girdles. Yeah, they were dressed ready to do business. They were dressed the same way Jesus was dressed in Revelation chapter 3, I think it was, when he walked amongst the seven churches of Asia, had on the golden girdle around his waist. And so they came out with pure linen on, with the breast girdle with golden girdles, but yet they still had business to do. They had in their hands the seven plagues, or the seven last plagues that would be poured on mankind at the time. And so verse 7 says, and one of the four beasts, stay with me, and one of the four beasts gave unto the seven angels seven golden vials. And these vials were vials that were full of the wrath of God. So grace and mercy is completed. Don't look for grace and mercy to be mixed with wrath. Because wrath is poured out as a last portion. It's poured out because God has now said, time is up. I give you all the chances I can give you. Now it's time for you to pay. They said that these vials were like bowls, and that the bowls held a certain amount of liquid, and when they pour it out, it would pour out all at one time. It wouldn't pour out properly or half of it. They would pour out completely. So when they poured out the vials, it would be a swift judgment. It would be a hot judgment. It would be a plague that only God could put on the people who decided that they were not going to worship the master and take on the mark of the beast. He says there were golden vials full of the wrath of God, but God, it says here, who liveth, how long?
Forever
and ever. So according to this text, God never dies. Did y'all know that? Y'all know God lives forever and ever? Huh? Y'all know the God you serve will never die, but heaven and earth shall pass away. God still will remain standing.
All right.
Can I get a witness? His word will remain standing when heaven and earth shall burn up, and a new heaven and new earth appear. His word will still be there. Woo! That's why I can trust in the Lord, because I know that now, tomorrow, and 100,000 million, trillion, billion years from now, God will still be God. Oh my God, y'all ain't catch that. When everything have gone on, your friends have turned their back on you, when your children left and standing there, God is still God.
All right, all right. All right.
Trick God mighty. And still able.
Yes.
To perform miracles.
Yes.
Still able.
Yes.
To feed the hungry. God Almighty, they help you pay your rent. Still able to fill your refrigerator. God is able to do anything. He'll heal your broken, wounded body.
Yes,
it's called
yes,
God.
Yes.
Yes. Great God Almighty.
Yes.
Woo! God live forever. And ever. Why am I saying this? Because the text says it. Not only the text says it, we know it's true, and such is true. I'm going to trust in the Lord all my life, because when this life over, I'll take my wings and fly away to be with God in the heavens. Woo! If you think you're going to die, that's it. You got something coming with you. You better go back and check it out. Huh? We were born to die. But we die, we're going to live again somewhere. Heaven or hell.
All right.
Take your spot.
Take
your choice.
All right.
You won't say, God, you didn't give me a chance to make it to heaven, because he will tell you, depart from me, you work of iniquity. I tell you now. You're not going to say, God didn't give you a chance to know right from wrong, because he's always working on you, talking to you, working on your conscience, trying to get you to see, get right before it's ever too late. some of them still keep procrastinating, saying, I've got another thing, and I'll get back tomorrow, God. Mm-hmm. And God said, tomorrow ain't promised to you.
That's right.
We got your own right. Salvation today.
Today.
Today is the day of salvation.
All right.
And verse 8, you got to hear. And the temple, the temple of heaven was filled with smoke. Look at this. From the what? Glory of God. Where else? And from his power. God's glory and his power caused the temple to be filled with smoke. Go to Isaiah real quick. Isaiah chapter 6, I believe. Isaiah chapter 6. And let's see. Now he said the temple was filled with smoke from the glory of God and his power in heaven. Now let's see what happens on earth. Isaiah chapter 6. Are y'all with me?
Yeah.
In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Look at what happened. And above stood the seraphims. Each one had six wings. With twain he covered his face. And with twain he covered his feet. And with twain, what else did he do? He did fly. And one cried unto another and said, what? Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole world, earth, is full of what? His glory. And the post of the doors moved at the voice of him that cried. And the house was what?
Filled
with what? Filled with smoke. The glory of God smoked the place up. The glory of God smoked the place up. But I will go a little further. Then said I, who was Isaiah, woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of the people of unclean lips. For mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Then flew one of the seraphims unto me, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken from the tongs, with the tongs from off the altar. And he laid it upon my mouth, and said, lo, this have touched thy lips, and thy iniquity is taken away, and thy sin purged. And also I heard a voice from the Lord saying, whom shall I what? Send. And who will what? Go for us. Then said I, then said Isaiah, what did he say? Here am I, send me. Isaiah said, here am I, send me. All of us have to say, here am I, send me. You ever need somebody, Lord, just send me, and I'll do your work. Let's finish it. And the temple was filled with the smoke from the glory of God.